Hello and welcome to coverage of Pro Tour Magic 2015. We're in Portland, Oregon. I'm Marshall Sutcliffe with Zach Hill in the booth, and we are in for the second quarterfinal match here. Matt Sperling, Team Channel Fireball Pantheon, he's playing essentially a burn deck, a current level burn deck, playing against Yvonne Floch. You can see him there. And he is playing the opposite of that. He is playing the low win condition, long game control deck. Basically, these players have taken complete polar opposite approaches to this format, yet both found themselves in the top eight here, Zach.
Yeah, I mean, these are both weirdly decks kind of popularized by longtime Magic veteran Adrian Sullivan. You've got the burn deck that basically has inevitability through the ability to just point spells at the opponent's face that they can't interact with. And then the white-blue control deck that has inevitability through just drawing cards and gaining life until your opponent is just nothing they do matters. So, I mean, really a pretty classic matchup. Both of these archetypes, these strategies, have been around for as long as the game has. Really interested to see how this matchup goes in its current iteration and standard.
All right, Sperling's going to take a couple damage here to play a Sacred Foundry. And an interesting start here for Sperling. He's actually gone 2-drop into 3-drop creature, though his deck doesn't run that many creatures.
Right, yeah, I think he's only got Pyromancer and Phoenix, maybe, I think an Eidolon of the Great Revel.
Correct.
In the main deck. He's got definitely a lot more of those in the sideboard. But Phoenix, very powerful in this matchup. Floch does not have Detention Sphere. He's got a couple of Last Breaths. But by and large, he plans on killing creatures by destroying them, not exiling them. And that means that Phoenix is going to come back over and over again, turn after turn, as Sperling points burn spells at Floch.
That's right. Young Pyromancer hits the red zone, gets first blood there, Yvonne down to 18. This is Yvonne's first Pro Tour top eight. This is also Matt Sperling's first Pro Tour top eight. So this is both of their first time under the lights on a Sunday here at the Pro Tour stage. They've both had plenty of success in their long careers in Magic, but this is the pinnacle for them so far.
So there's some really interesting strategy going on with Sperling. Even just right now, you see shocks in Sperling's hand, so that allows him to shock, get Phoenix back, theoretically cast it and attack right away, also giving him a token, but he knows the way that Floch can kill his creatures is through mass removal effects. So there's also, you know, theories you could have about, okay, well, maybe I should leverage my Pyromancer, make him use Verdict on that.
Interesting. So Yvonne Floch is going to go for Azorius Charm to really guarantee that he keeps hitting those land drops. He's got a Mutavault activation available, but it feels super risky to activate a Mutavault against Matt Sperling's deck. That's just not something that Floch is really going to be want to do here.
Sperling doesn't have the fourth land to go shock into Phoenix, dealing 6 damage on that attack, but you're right. Yeah, Floch can't aggressively block with that Mutavault, so I think Sperling, I mean, this is the stage of the game where you just start, you know, slinging burn spells, shock, shock, skullcrack, helix, helix, blood. If all those cards are able to fire, that's, what, 6, 9, 13, 17 damage right there. So Sperling has enough burn in his hand to kill Floch. He's just got to figure out how to cast it all. And Searing Blood in particular, not just a whole lot of targets in this matchup.
No, I think Mutavault and Soldier Token, I think, are the only ones. That being said, all right, so here's, and you're going to see this from Floch. He's using a Supreme Verdict to take out one young Pyromancer. That's because he knows that there's very few targets in Sperling's deck that he wants to use it on, and young Pyromancer is one of the best ones. Interestingly here, I think, you know, the card that I keep staring at in Sperling's hand is Skullcrack. That just seems like such a huge card in this matchup because of its interaction with Sphinx's Revelation.
Yeah, Skullcrack was 14. Printed in Gatecrashes back when I was still in R&D. Actually as an answer to Sphinx's Revelation, specifically so you could cast it and mitigate that big life gain effect. So very, very, very important when Floch fires off one of those big revs. And actually, I think Sperling's in a pretty good position right now.
Floch is going to use up another Supreme Verdict just to take out a single Chandra's Phoenix.
And that's kind of what you have to do. I mean,
you
can't just keep getting hit with Phoenix, but it just does put you in a pretty awkward position.
Sperling's got a nice little draw here. He's got a young Pyromancer, still has four or five spells left in his hand after that, too.
And what you're going to see now, you see him leaving two mana up. We're at the point. Yeah.
Go ahead and make your point, and I know exactly where you're going, and so does Floch.
And we're at the point in the game where, you know, revelations are going to be big enough that Sperling can't really afford to let them resolve while gaining life. So Sperling basically going to be keeping up Skullcrack mana probably for the remainder of this match.
Wow, another Supreme Verdict here for Floch, and this one is cast off of a Quicken.
And you see kind of how awkward Supreme Verdict is in this match. I mean, it's been doing work, but he's kind of having to cast it just to eliminate not only one threat at a time, but threats that cost less mana than Supreme Verdict.
And threats that are going to come back pretty soon, too.
Right.
But, yeah, you know, Yvonne knows that, especially here in Game 1, when he's got some of the awkward cards, he needs to leverage those to the most of their ability, and that's what he's doing so far. But the real issue for Floch here is that he knows that Skullcrack is looming. Now, he doesn't actually know that, but given the fact that Sperling has been very carefully leaving up the two mana every single time, I think Floch is definitely going to be keenly aware of it. So here's a shock to Floch, and that's going to get back the Phoenix. That was on end step, and just more burn spells. They just never end for Matt Sperling.
Did you derive a lot of joy out of saying shock to Floch?
I did.
I mean, the thing about Skullcrack is Floch can fire off a revelation, get hit with a Skullcrack, and still just have drawn a lot of cards, one of which can be another revelation.
That's so true.
It's not as though revelation is blank, and I think you do kind of have to cast it. I just hope you draw another revelation, a way of gaining life. Now, Sperling has Boros Charm, untap into War Leader's Helix, can cast Chandra's Phoenix to attack. So Floch really does need to gain some more life.
Yeah, he really, I mean, that sequence that you just outlined actually just kills Floch.
Right.
Like, without the Phoenix. He's at 7.
Yeah, assuming the Helix resolves. I think
a
challenging thing about casting War Leader's Helix is your opponent's a deck with 4 dissolves in it. So it's going to be hard to find a window to cast a Helix. Whereas, like, dissolving a Chandra's Phoenix is awkward for a number of reasons. But you're right. I mean, Floch is in very, very real danger of dying.
Yeah, but he's going to get syncopated here, I think. Sperling is. Because it only costs 2 mana, and Floch can still leave up mana for a dissolve, which he does have in his hand. Oh, he did draw a second Sphinx's Revelation, too, so he can gain 4 life and just basically effectively counter that Boros Charm as well.
Wow.
The question is, does Floch think that Sperling has access to another Skullcrack? Because if he doesn't, then Flock's going to want to wait another turn, counter this. He might be lining up a dissolve here, actually. Yep.
And I think wants to save Syncopate for Chandra's Phoenix.
That's what I'm thinking, too.
But Floch's still in a lot of danger. I mean, he can only fire off a revelation for one that's effectively not a revelation right now. He can activate Mutavault and Last Breath it, which is actually relevant in this matchup.
Now, what do you think about... So there was an interesting moment a second ago where Sperling had Floch tapped out from the revelation and could have actually just fired the Boros Charm off there, but decided to wait until Floch's end step to do it. Is there a thought process there?
I think a thought process is you want to maybe bluff another Skullcrack.
Skullcrack? Okay.
But definitely, Marshall, that's a very valid line. I mean, you know, forcing through 4 damage when you have the opportunity is something that, you know, is extremely relevant when your opponent's at 7,
right,
potentially down to 3, and you can capitalize on it.
Right, because I think that the way you see these decks win a lot of times is when they get you low, and then they can resolve multiple burn spells where they just overload your ability to counter them. All right, Chandra's Phoenix hits.
And of course,
Last Breath.
Floch, if he doesn't want to use Syncopate, can just Last Breath the Phoenix.
And that does exile it, so that one's not coming back. Another play that we'll probably see from Floch potentially is Mutavault and then trying to Last Breath his own Mutavault to gain 4 life. That is a little trick that he'll have in his pocket as a last-case scenario. Unfortunately, your opponent's main decking Shock plus a bunch of other things that can go horribly awry. But all right, so Flock's got sort of the typical stuff for this deck. He's going to have to pull the trigger here pretty soon on that Sphinx's Revelation, though, because the problem is, of course, that if you wait too long and you go for it, if Matt just decides never to tap out, he can say, in response, here's 2 burn spells, you're dead.
And that's the thing that can happen. You know, the temptation is to try and play around everything. But the longer the game goes, the more your opponent is actually likely to be to just have the card. So it's a tension between wanting to see if you have a window to resolve a revelation and not giving your opponent time to draw the answer that he actually has.
Right. This might be the window right now for Floch to go for it. He's got Sperling down to just two lands left, but I think he knows that if Sperling has another skull crack, he's dead.
Right.
If he goes for it.
I mean, the other thing is that, like, you don't want to tap down too low, because even if you're able to gain, like, he could fire off a revelation for five, six now with that hallowed fountain.
He's actually going to three here off of that fountain, indicating his intentions. Oh, he's going for four here.
And he's keeping syncopate mana up.
So he is fully playing around Skullcrack here. Now, Sperling doesn't happen to have it here. Does this signal to Sperling? Is the only card that Floch can have there syncopate? Like, he's not main decking negate or anything like that.
Yeah, I think it very loudly signals the syncopate. But the thing is, having to take two damage and Floch resolving that revelation, going up to nine is still very, very much within striking distance.
Yeah, we see that Sperling's got two Warleader's Helix in his hand here.
I mean, now
that's most of the work right there.
Yeah, exactly. And now's a phenomenal window to actually resolve one of that Warleader's Helix if he wanted to. Also is going to be able to resolve Chandra's. And I mean, attacking for four, Floch is still in big trouble.
I think that Flock's going to be forced to fire off that Azorius Charm, but I love this play from Sperling here. Completely getting around Syncopate. And still getting in for a huge... I mean, four is a lot at this stage of the game, especially given what Sperling has in his hand.
I think what Floch wants to do is draw an Elixir of Immortality, shuffle back some of the Last Breath and Sphinx's Revelation, all big game at this point. And obviously the five life, putting him back to a healthy 14, if he's able to do that.
All right, so Chandra's Phoenix back on top of the library. He's going to take two, drop to seven. Sperling's going to pass a turn with only one untapped mana. So Floch can try to do... I mean, if he had another revelation, he could do it. I don't think he does, though.
He's got Divination, Jace, Quicken, so he can draw a lot of cards. He just has to draw those cards before Sperling can resolve Warleader's Helix. Because even tapping three mana for Divination on his turn, every mana he taps on his turn makes it harder to win a fight with Syncopate over the flurry of burn spells that Sperling could have in his hand.
Really tough spot for Floch here. I mean, he's done a good job maneuvering, but I feel like Sperling is mounting enough pressure here that he's just going to be able to overload Yvonne Floch with burn spells at some point after pecking away with these creatures.
I mean, Sperling can just attack with Mutavault, demand an answer. He can cast Chandra's. He can leave mana up for Warleader's Helix. If he taps low, he's not going to be able to Searing Blood Flock's Mutavault, which might give Floch a window to use that.
Yeah, this is big. If Floch decides to try to block with Mutavault, it's going to open up Searing Blood, and there are precious few targets for Matt Sperling to even point that Searing Blood at, and if he gets to take out a Mutavault with it, it is going to be huge. It's also going to put Floch into death range of two different cards in Sperling's hand here. Wow! So a Quicken before blocks reveals Sphinx's Revelation.
Yeah, and that third Revelation is absolutely game-changing. That means if Floch gets to untap, he can fire off something that'll really take him out of range. That also allows him to strategically just fight a counter war over the Searing Blood if that's what ends up happening. It gives him the option of actually just casting Revelation this turn, but I think he's just using those Quicken plus Divination. Just get a lot more information now before he makes a decision.
Okay, so he's going to fire off a instant speed Divination here. Draw a couple of cards, two lands. Sperling's got four untapped mana. And I think four cards in hand, Zach.
That's what it looks like to me. He's got Searing Blood, a pair of Warleader's Helix, and Chandra's Phoenix. Sperling checking out the graveyard, saying, okay, what is Floch likely to have? What do I need to worry about playing around? question is, you know, do you activate Mutavault? Are you willing to fall to five?
Another quicken here for Floch.
Now, this is actually really relevant because if he activates Mutavault to block and Sperling Searing Bloods it, he actually doesn't have enough mana to syncopate the Searing Blood successfully unless he taps his Mutavault, which still results in him taking two more damage.
Yeah.
You see Floch
I think that says it all, right? Yeah.
I mean, all of that being said, he can fall to five, untap, and just jam a Revelation out there. You know, syncopating for two just to tap Sperling out, tap him out of the potential for skull cracking, is a relevant piece of information for Floch to have. Opens up a big window for a huge Revelation.
This is pretty incredible stuff, Zach. I mean, we're talking about it as if Floch just knows for sure about the Searing Blood, right?
Oh, right,
like,
right,
I mean,
right,
you know,
right.
There's so much that's going to happen here. All right, there we go. And there it is. Sperling can't wait to fire off Searing Blood. And there it is. He's doing exactly what you said, Zach. He is attempting to tap out Matt Sperling and does it. Remember, this is all on Sperling's turn. So he takes five here. Drops down to two, and Sperling, of course, has to know what's going to happen here.
Wow.
And it is going to be for seven.
So, I mean, that only gets Floch to nine. I mean, Sperling with an attack for two from Mutavault, four from Warleader's Helix can get him down to three, but Floch is to the point where he's going to start being able to chain Elixirs and Sphinx's Revelations very, very soon. Sperling also could have just played a land in shock, but Flock's seen two shocks already, didn't really fear that last turn.
He's discarding a few lands. All right. So let's see if Sperling can put together a comeback hand here.
Oh, man. Four more damage.
Is that Stoke the Flames?
It is Stoke the Flames. He's got a lot of lines. He can play Phoenix Attack with Mutavault. He can cast a Helix Attack with Mutavault. He can cast Stoke.
All right, so hit you for four while you're completely tapped out. Drop you down to five, Floch, and ship the turn back with just one mana available. All right, so what can Floch do here? Did he find another Sphinx's Revelation? He's got Matt Sperling with just one mana up, so he knows he can't get skullcracked here, but Sperling looks like he has put the pedal to the metal on this game, and I think that Floch is going to have to do something huge here very quickly, because I think that Sperling's had enough fussing around and he's going to start just throwing those spells at Flock's face.
Yeah, I agree. I mean, what Floch has to draw are counter spells, the fourth Revelation, remember he's used three already, or Elixir of Immortality. Those are the spells that are live. The creature removal, the creatures in Sperling's deck have already done their damage. Sperling just waiting for a window to unleash those big helixes, Stoke the Flames. I mean, four damage is a lot of damage as a burn deck. That said, Floch has Jace Architect of Thoughtx to Azorius Charm Quicken, can draw, you know, it can look at potentially six cards if he wants to. It takes a lot of mana to do that. Realistically, though, he can still see about four cards this turn without having to commit too much. So a lot can happen on this turn for Floch. The question is, how does he want to sequence his plays?
Right, and he has to do something. Right now, his hand is not going to win. He will lose to Sperling's hand, given what he's got now. The Jaces don't do much on their own. Supreme Verdict isn't doing enough. Planar Cleansing too. Azorius Charm even quickened. So he needs to find some of those counter spells you just mentioned a second ago, Zach, or the last Revelation.
Yeah, Quicken Supreme Verdict saves him from the line of activate Mutavault Attack with Phoenix. Azorius Charm can save him two damage. But wow, just passing without being able to cast Jace. I mean, this opens Floch up. That means he's only able to draw two cards maximum this turn.
Is he trying to bait Matt Sperling into activating that Mutavault here and get him with Planar Cleansing? Is that what his line is? Because he's left up so much extra mana. You know, you kind of assumed he would play Jace, plus or minus Jace, whatever he saw fit, and then kind of take it from there. But now he's just passed the turn back with a million mana open. And there's an Eidolon of the Great Revel. And that's going to make that Quicken pretty awkward, and I feel like Floch might need to respond to that with the Quicken here if that's his plan.
levels, I'll play Kukan.
Okay. Kukan into Syncopate.
And that's live, because Syncopate pretty easily can counter these big burn spells.
He also could counter the Eidolon if he wanted.
Right.
He doesn't. He's just going to go for the good old Wrath. Supreme Verdict. And Sperling's going to pass the turn back. So Sperling not falling for it, leaving his Mutavault back. And Floch manages to take nothing. Sperling, so close. He's got Floch down to 5, and he has 2 different spells that do 4. What does Floch find?
He draws Last Breath, which can deal with the Mutavault, but Flock's Mutavault dying to Searing Blood. No longer the option to Last Breath his own spells. He needs to hit something off this Jace. Syncopate buys him a turn, but Sperling can come right back at him with a Mutavault attack and another 4 damage spell.
There it is.
Lethal.
Elixir of Immortality. Wow. He's found it. He's also going to find out if Sperling has a Skullcrack.
Yeah.
But he's got the Syncopate now as well, so...
And that is exactly what he needed to find. Also, unlike a Revelation, it doesn't require him to tap low. He can Elixir and activate it with plenty of Syncopate mana up. That was a huge draw for Floch. And Floch with that glib smile. It's so hard to get a read on. He always feels like he just has it every single time.
Huh. I think that Eidolon may have attacked the turn it came into play.
Yeah. I think it did. Ultimately,
there was
it wasn't
sequence.
A consequence.
Right.
Because it just died. Sperling knows that Floch's removal spells are essentially all mass removal, so ultimately it didn't have an impact on the game. But yeah, I think you're exactly right.
I think it battled. Because there was that big flurry when it was on the stack. Okay.
I mean, that's what Quicken does, right? It gives a creature haste? Okay, well, maybe not.
It certainly doesn't make Floch's deck any faster, I'll tell you that. Now, he needs to just crack this immediately, right? Where he can still leverage Syncopate to the most of its ability?
I think so, unless you want to maybe, cycle an Azorius Charm first, but that seems a little risky, yeah. But
on his turn.
Yeah, uh-huh. I think so. I don't think you want to give your opponent just more mana to be able to try and work around activating it. Respond to your Syncopate. Yeah, the temptation is to always do stuff at instant speed on your opponent's turn. I guess that's what he does. It might be right.
Response. All right, so we have a response here. Syncopate for 1. So counter it. But now he needs to crack the Elixir, right? There we go. So he's got Matt tapped out. No fear of Skullcrack here.
And relevantly, shuffling Syncopate back into his deck. Syncopate, one of his many live cards. You want, when you activate Elixir of Immortality, to just increase the density of relevant live spells in your deck. That's what the card does. So every single one of a copy of a spell that you care about gives you just that much more advantage.
Sure. Now, is there a line here for Matt to win this turn? With some type of fortunate draw here or something? I mean, Floch's at 9. He's got a Mutavault in play. There's a Phoenix in the yard. There's a Warleader's Helix in his hand. Can he piece together 9 damage in one turn? It feels like a stretch.
Floch has Last Breath Azorius Charm, so that Mutavault not going to deal damage. I think Sperling just wants to draw, Skullcracks until the end of time.
Right.
He still can create a relevant play. I mean, he's going to force the Last Breath or Charm by either attacking Jace or attacking Floch. He can get through. I mean, he wants 8 mana, but he doesn't have it. He has 7. So he can't get through both Helix and Stoke the Flames. We can force action here and resolve at least one of those 4 damage spells, which forces Floch to draw something.
This is a nice one from Floch. He's going to use Azorius Charm to put Mutavault back on top and kind of strand a bunch of cards in Sperling's hand. He's got 2 4 mana burn spells and a mountain.
So Sperling can kill Jace if he wants to. He can deal 4 to the face if he wants to.
You.
Yeah.
You, he says. Redirect? No way, right?
I mean, it's really challenging. Jace represents, right now there are 4 Sphinx's Revelations in Floch's deck.
Oh, man.
So every single card is just a clock ticking down. And so he's got to compute, is an activation of Jace more or less likely to be worth 4 life points?
Okay.
And I don't know what the answer to that question is.
Looks like he's thinking about it right now. I think he did kill Jace. He killed Jace. And this is just such a tough fight for Matt Sperling. Once you're forced to start throwing burn spells at your opponent's planeswalkers, now all of a sudden they're pulling double duty, protecting his life total. Was that a divination?
That was a divination. And, I mean, this is what Floch's deck does. Once you activate Elixir and the ball gets rolling, divination 2 cards. This Jace is going to look at 3 cards.
Yikes.
9 life means that Sperling just does not quite have enough mana or cards to finish Floch off. He's got 4 damage. Mutavault, Floch knows is on top of Sperling's deck, so he doesn't have to worry about a top deck now. And Jace and Azorius Charm Mutavault, just more and more relevant cards. The game's spiraling further and further out of control for Sperling.
Wow. And you got to figure that Yvonne Floch is his deck gets a lot better post-board. I'm assuming we're going to have a chat with him that BDM sat down with, but I mean, he's got so many cards that are just super awkward, like those Supreme Verdicts. He's managed to leverage them pretty decently, but he's one for one with his 2 drops. Like, you know, it's not exactly what he wants to see at this point.
I know he's got 4 copies, I think, of Nyx Fleece Ram in the sideboard.
Oh,
just an absolute nightmare for red decks.
Wow.
Yeah.
All right, Stoke the Flames, target you.
Resolves.
It resolves. That's going to get back a Phoenix.
Yeah, Phoenix.
He's going to play it and attack and last breath the Phoenix. So Floch's down to 5 now.
30. Yep.
And I believe that Sperling's out of cards. Yeah, he's empty. So here we go. Can Floch turn this thing around? He needs to gain some life again. I mean, there's some number of turns that he's going to have to gain some amount of life, and then he's going to really put this thing away. And there's the Sphinx's revelation. Right on time. He's probably going to fire it off right now. Maybe during the upkeep so that he can keep all the cards, but either way, boom. 10.
Jeez.
And Floch jumps up to 15. And if you're sitting in Sperling's seat, that's got to feel like the nails in the coffin on game one.
I'm trying to think about what the reason for main phasing it is. I think you can draw land Elixir of Immortality and cast it right away, which seems really, really, really good.
Mm.
Just get more information, make sure Sperling doesn't have any mana untapped, play an extra land.
Go to discard.
No. I mean, this is this is exactly the situation that you do not want to be in against a Sphinx's Revelation deck, where they just have a grip full of cards, a healthy life total, and now they're making decisions about what they don't want the most. I mean, they're going to keep 7 of the best cards in their entire deck in their hand. This is a massive uphill battle for Sperling to fight.
So Floch discarding to hand size here, but it looks like he's turned the corner fully and is going to be able to craft a win here as piling together 15 damage for Matt Sperling while drawing 1 card a turn is just not going to be realistic. He finds a lightning strike. He can attack with Mutavault here.
And look at that hand from Floch. Syncopate, Dissolve.
Jeez.
Jace for more cards. Pair of Quickens, can cycle those.
He's going to plus Jace this time and pass a turn back.
I think Floch is thinking about, okay, now we're near the stage of the game where I can start to really think about how to put this game away. Sperling drew a Chandra's Phoenix, so this is relevant for Floch, as he can use Quicken into Supreme Verdict to deal with it. He can also Azorius Charm it back to the top of the deck. He can Syncopate it if he wants it to, but it's still going to mandate some sort of answer.
Yeah. All right, here's Quicken. Even though the Mutavault's only a 1-1, Verdict it away. And now this is where Yvonne Floch has such an embarrassment of riches that he can just start throwing, like, any 1-for-1 he'll take. Just, right. It doesn't matter what it is.
And I like syncopating that Phoenix just to not have to worry about it.
Floch taps out. Sperling doesn't use his lightning strike, but the writing's on the wall here as Floch now gets to go through a bunch more cards in his deck with those Quickens and that type of thing.
Okay.
It's cosmic bowling time here in the feature manager area.
You're just starting.
Floch. We're just starting.
That's the stage subtly reacting to the gloom that is hanging over this match.
I have 12 cards in my hand to say that.
Keep drawing. Can't see anything.
I can go to discard.
I don't know.
I think I play with blinds this turn, right?
Yes, you did.
Okay.
He's trying to remember what he played, but he can't see it. So. Hey guys, welcome back to the booth. We'll pop over here while we get the lights back up to speed in our feature match area. But, you know, we've really seen Ivan Floch turn the corner here. And what I'm starting to turn my focus to, you know, I don't like to end the game too early, but I just can't see a way for Sperling to come back from what Flock's going to be able to do as far as card velocity goes. Assuming that Floch is able to finish it off, what I'm really curious is, doesn't this matchup just get better for Floch post-board?
I mean, that would be my assumption because he has so many cards that are just not that exciting. I mean, on the other hand, if he, like, boards out all of his cleansing and verdicts, that means that, you know, Sperling just board in some more creatures. So we'll have to see what happens.
All right, we're back down in the feature match area here. We've got Jace, Architect of Thought, ticking upwards. So whenever I see Floch do that, I know he's now going for the kill.
Yes, exactly. I mean, unless there's, like, a board full of 1/1s or something, usually you're just using Jace to draw cards until you're trying to put the game away.
Right, and now he's firmly in put-the-game-away mode. Upkeep. He's got a million lands. And there's an upkeep effect here for Matt Sperling.
Stoke you.
So Floch has to be careful, right? You don't want to make a silly slip up here down the stretch when you have all the tools you need to win the game. He's done all the heavy lifting, and he's just going to counter it. Dissolve.
Oh, yeah, you upkeep. So draw.
I might just fire off a medium-sized revelation here in case there's anything else he wants to do on his main phase. Might also just tap out.
And go.
He's going to say go here.
Now in your upkeep.
And during your upkeep. Now how big is this going to be for a flaw? Okay. 7.
All the way back up to 20. Went as low as 2 in this match. All the way up to 20. That is exactly what this deck does.
Yep.
Go on.
And that's going to do it. Matt Sperling has seen enough. Ivan Floch sitting at 20 life after having his life total fluctuate all over the place over the course of that match. You get a look at our viewing area there just for a moment, but we've got, you know, this event is open up to the public. So we do have the ability to, people can come here if you're in the area and watch on the screen out in the floor. It's pretty exciting stuff as we go down. So what we've got is BDM actually had a chat with Ivan Floch and talk to him about what his sideboard plan was for this specific matchup. Let's take a look at that.
All right, Ivan, tell me what you do in this sideboarding plan to offset all the firepower in Matt's deck.
First thing I want to say is that sideboarding is really tricky in this matchup because he has multiple threats in Chandra and his creatures, which obviously I need to answer in different ways. And also, he has so many cyber cards for my Nyxfreeze Rams and Archangels of Trune. And the tricky part is how many of those answers he will cyber in, and how many of answers of mine I want to have against his creatures and his Chandras. Basically, it's going to be very different on play on draw. And I'll definitely cyber in Rams, Last Breads, which are great, and Archangels, maybe. Maybe not, because if he sides like all Glory of Heresies and Chain to the Rogues and Banishing Gliding, he has like multiple answers for Archangel, and it might be not that good. And that's it. And the question is how many counters I keep for his Chandra, and how many creature removal I keep his for early creatures and mutables and pyromancers.
So it's a little bit of a guessing game.
Yes, it's really a little bit of a guessing game. It's going to be different on play on the draw. On play, I need more super verdicts. On draw, on play, I need less super verdicts. On draw, I need more. So we'll see.
Okay, good luck the rest of the match.
Thank you.
All right, so interesting stuff there. He didn't sound, it didn't sound like the matchup really changed that much post-board. It sounded like maybe it tilted in his favor a little bit.
Well, I think it's, yeah, it's less a question of percentages, mm-hmm. Because it's really more of a guessing game, because the percentages are going to be very different depending on whether you guessed right or wrong. If you leave in, you know, a bunch of creature removal and you're Sperling, and your opponent doesn't have Archangel of Thunes and is leaning on the Rams less heavily, obviously you're making your deck way worse, and it's kind of like rock, paper, scissors. You guessed wrong, and so your opponent has a huge edge. If you guess right and you can position those cards correctly against each other, I think you're putting yourself in a position to win the match. So, you know, this is exactly the art of sideboarding. This is constructed level Magic at its finest.
Love it. Let's see what Matt Sperling thinks about sideboarding for this matchup.
All right, Matt, tell me what the plan is for the sideboarded games in this matchup against Ivan.
All right, so the sideboarding plan is actually mostly dictated by the fact that there's 8 cards in your main deck that are really bad. Those are 4 Shocks and 4 Searing Blood. 2 damage to a creature, obviously ineffective against blue-white with no creatures. Shock for 2, you know, just not enough. So basically, we're going to look to the sideboard to try to find 8 cards that are productive. Skullcrack, Chandra, Eidolon, Glare, these are the cards you really want. And you'll see that adds up to 6. So you've got 2 more slots, and then a Banishing Light and a Wear and Tear. Those aren't effective at all against Ivan's main deck, but when he brings in those Rams, the 05 that gains life, you're going to want something to take those out. So you're looking at a Wear and Tear, a Banishing Light, a Skullcrack, a Glare, Eidolon, and 2 Chandra. Now, on the draw, you could also board out like a Mountain for 1 Chain to the Rocks. That gives you another way to deal with the Angel that he's bringing in or the Ram. That's kind of, I haven't quite decided, committed to what I'm going to do there. I think I'll probably bring in 1 Chain to the Rocks. There's actually some more counterplay there, because then your opponent can Planar Cleansing, get rid of the Chain to the Rocks, and really kind of blow you out. If you don't bring in Chain to the Rocks, you're not vulnerable to that. So there's a little bit of a, perhaps a cat and mouse. Will he leave in 3 Planar Cleansing? Will he leave in 1, 2? It's unclear. So maybe I'll have to get a feel in game 2 and go from there.
Okay, good luck the rest of the match.
Thank you, appreciate it.
All right, so you heard it from Matt there. Perhaps a game of cat and mouse you were talking about in those terms as well. Players are now presenting their deck, so they've made their decisions and they've decided, you know, look into the other person's eyes and figure, I don't really know, you know, what the criteria is for how many creatures my opponent's going to play, and I don't think they do either.
Yeah, and I mean, a lot of these players have been playtesting over and over with their teammates last night, you know, prior to today, but at the end of the day, your teammates' preferences may be different from your opponent's. At a certain point, it's kind of left up to fate.
It looks like the players are ready to fight here. And they're underway, so Mutavault to start things off for Sperling. That usually indicates that Mutavault's ready to rumble on turn 2.
Yeah. And that's actually pretty big for Sperling being on the play, because Floch can't get Azorius Charm or Last Breath up. So essentially by playing Mutavault and just committing to attacking with it, he just gets in a free 2 damage. You know, normally you don't want to start attacking with Mutavault incredibly early because it impedes your development, but you know these games are going to go long. Sperling is not a blitz red deck. He's a burn deck. So every single point of damage matters.
Okay, so Young Pyromancer, and there's another one in hand here. Wow, what a stacked hand for Sperling. He's got 2 Warleader's Helix that he's not going to be able to play for a while, it looks like, but those will come in handy down the line. Wow, 3 Warleader's Helix and 2 Lightning Strike? Okay.
But not another land. I mean,
no.
I can see if you're Sperling just not attacking here with Pyromancer, just so that you don't get charmed and start missing land drops.
What did he draw for the turn? Did he draw a land?
Yeah, he
yes,
did.
He
okay.
did, although it's not a white mana source, and he is going to attack. It's going to get charmed. Does he just fire off a lightning strike at Flock's face here and make a token?
Yeah, I absolutely love that play.
All right. There we go.
Spell 20, Flock 17.
Pass the turn back to Flock. Now, Flock did not have the Nyx Fleece Ram there on turn 2, or if he did, he decided to use the Azorius Charm. Yeah, he doesn't have one. He had 4 on the board, right?
Yeah, I think he had 4 on the board.
Yeah.
Definitely, there's no universe in which you don't bring them all in. Sperling, I think, trying to say, yeah, okay, I'm going to recommit that Pyromancer to the board. So it already dealt one damage, essentially that token, and if Floch doesn't have Supreme Verdict, it's going to deal a lot more.
Mutavault for Floch. Passes a turn back. Sperling draws another Mutavault, so it's a welcome fourth land. Unfortunately, it's still not a white mana source, so those Warleader's Helix are going to be stuck in his hand for a while. I don't know that that's a huge deal, though, as these games tend to go long anyway. He'll probably find a white mana source at some point anyway.
Yeah, and by being, I mean, he could still attack for five this turn with Lightning Strike up. I mean, a pretty serious offense, and Floch has Azorius Charm to delay it a little bit, but the rest of his hand, just Syncopate and Revelation. I mean, Flock's under a lot of pressure.
2, 4, 5 damage. Flock's got another Charm.
And Charming it is good here. I think Floch needs to do that, but it prevents him from drawing a card. I mean, he needs more interaction beyond that Sphinx's Revelation because it's not big enough to just win him the game when he cast it. He's also going to have to worry about just getting attacked with both those Mutavaults for the rest of this game.
Right. And Pyromancer back on top now. Sperling does not use that moment to fire off the Lightning Strike.
Yeah, because if he Lightning Strikes right away, Floch can activate Mutavault and just block the token, so he doesn't really net a token if he does that.
So there's no big point. Also, he would walk into a Syncopate, which Floch happens to have.
Right. But he was able to connect for 3 damage, so Floch down to 13 with 15 points of burn in Sperling's hand. Again, the question, as always, is how fast can he cast those burn spells? Floch has Quicken. Look at another card. He's going to want to keep Syncopate mana up. Scrying first to see what his card is. Just get more information.
Keeps it on top. Here's a big draw step. It is another young pirate. Oh, that was the one on top.
Yep,
sorry,
right,
I forgot about that. Right. A second Azorius Charm. So, young Pyromancer now. Still threatening to keep spewing out tokens thanks to that Lightning Strike and then potentially the Warleader's Helix going forward.
I think this is actually a really hard turn for Sperling. He can attack with 2 Mutavaults and a token. He could not attack with a token because of the threat of Floch's Mutavault. He can attack with 1 and try to cast the Pyromancer. He can leave open 2 to try and Lightning Strike the Mutavault. A lot of lines he could take, even though there's, you know, only so many permanents on the battlefield. Sperling, by keeping red up, of course, representing the Searing Blood that hit Floch pretty hard last game. Floch has to assume he's not going to leave it in, but last thing he wants to do is walk into it.
Flock's tanked out pretty hard here. He's going to make a Mutavault, though. He certainly doesn't want to get Searing Blooded here, but it's Lightning Strike instead, and that's going to get syncopated, but not a great sequence there for Sperling, as he doesn't have the young Pyromancer on the battlefield anymore, but he still has both Mutavaults active. Flock's down to 11 now, but kind of, ooh, there's an Ixfleece ramp, but kind of creeping up the scale here as he's going to be hitting his 6th land drop. Sort of slowly pushing things forward.
I'm looking at Flock's actual sideboard plan. We just heard he actually did not bring in Archangel of Thune, brought in 4 Ixfleece ram, 2 Last Breath, that's it. Taking down a Dissolve, 2 Planar Cleansing, 2 Supreme Verdict, and a Divination. So basically just shaving numbers off his main deck. Meanwhile, Matt, like we heard, no Shocks, no Searing Bloods for Skullcrack, Banishing Light, Glare, Chandra, Eidolon, and Wear and Tear. So to the extent that it's binary, which it's not, I think Floch won the game of cat and mouse a little bit. Not a whole lot of targets beyond Ram for Banishing Light, Glare of Heresy. With only 1 Planar Cleansing in Floch's deck, though, and minus a counterspell in the form of Dissolve, not that many answers to Chandra. Yeah.
Ixfleece ram. Yep. Play a land and say go. You see that Floch's put a dice on top of his library as well to remind him to gain that life.
So that is a Battlefield Forge for Sperling. That means that all of those War Leaders Helix are live. And what that also means is that he doesn't necessarily have to care about Nyx Fleece Ram that much. And you see him... Oh, okay, I thought he said go, and I was like, is he slow rolling the Battlefield Forge?
I thought he said go, too. But so there's Quicken on Anstep here. Finds him a Dissolve. Is there anything he wants to play otherwise? No. Gain one life and start creeping back up every turn that goes by. It just gets better and better for Floch. The longer that Nyx Fleece Ram is around, starts basically netting card advantage.
Yeah, right. Because Sperling wants to trade cards for life, that means that any life that you're able to gain is essentially like casting discard spells on your opponent. You know, sort of a tricky calculus there, but...
It's true. It equates out quite directly when you think about it that way.
So you see Glare on Sperling's end. That gets rid of the Ram and gives him a token from Pyromancer. I don't think he can, you know, save Glare for Angel. I mean, A, he doesn't know whether Angel's in the deck. I mean, it happens not to be, but, I mean, he's got to get that Ram off the table. He just says go.
All right, Sphinx's Revelation for four, the full tap out. Yvonne Floch just going for it here. And Matt's got to pick up the pen, so Flock's got to be relieved to see that. Jumps up to 16 life. He's going to be at 17, assuming the Ram is still around. And he's going to have a nice grip of cards here as well. He finds another Revelation as well. You mentioned it earlier, Zach. It's so key to chain those together.
It's really not using the opportunity for Floch tapped out to cast Warleader's Helix. Looks like he's saving it. Again, might be fearing Archangel a little bit. Warleader's Helix, one of the cards that can kill Archangel. But, I mean, Floch, another life from the Ram. Four life from the Revelation. Another Revelation. I mean, that was a huge turn. Very important.
Yeah, that could have been Yvonne Floch turning the corner again. Now, I wouldn't put it in the he's got it locked up camp here yet, but I feel like it's his game to lose at this point, especially with the addition of that second Nyx Fleece Ram that's going to start gaining tons of life every turn.
Three cards.
This could be heading down a very dark path for Matt Sperling very quickly here. That Sphinx's Revelation resolving, finding another Sphinx's Revelation could just be doom here for Sperling. Floch's at 17. Like,
yeah.
Sperling's got a long way to go here, and Floch has the tools he needs to prevent that from happening. So here,
I'm gonna take one.
Gonna take a damage there from the Forge, 22. And he's gonna Glare of Heresy, one Nyx Fleece Ram. But now Floch has mana and cards so that he can think about countering. He's going to. He's gonna dissolve the Glare of Heresy here.
Yeah, because those Rams are big. I mean, you just sit and gain two life a turn. I mean, most of your opponent's burn spells deal between 3 and 4 damage. That's like half a card every single turn of the game. Plus, being able to block for three is, you know, massive. I mean, that's three more damage he's just not taking.
Now, is Sperling forced to use a War Leader's Helix on one of these Nyx Fleece Rams?
I mean, I think so.
Damage.
Yeah.
I think so. I mean, you've got to get it off the battlefield. You get another 21. Token. And, I mean, that's awkward because that just makes Floch's Planar Cleansings and Supreme Verdicts even more powerful because, you know, they take out the Ram anyway. I mean, Ram just
25.
Totally dictates the tenor of this match.
I like the fact that Sperling has Floch down to just one Nyx Fleece Ram and he's got four creatures plus two Mutavaults, but this feels like a really steep hill to climb here for Sperling, especially given what we know, which are the cards in his hand. There's no Skullcrack there.
I mean, if Floch casts Planar Cleansing, Sperling can attack him right back down to 10 and Helix him down to 6. But again, he's just got to fear the untap into Revelation. I mean, what Sperling needs to do is just draw Skullcracks for the rest of the game.
Yeah, and he doesn't have one now, and here is a Revelation for 6. And if that first one wasn't slamming the door on this match, it feels like this one certainly should.
I'll go to discard.
Floch immediately going to discard step. couple of lands hit the bin, and he just says go at a cushy 20 life here. There's the Chandra's Phoenix for Sperling. He still has a nice board state, though, with double Mutavault and four other creatures. He can get in for a decent crack of damage here, but the problem, of course, is when Floch untaps again.
Right.
That's the problem, is that Sperling certainly can't close this game out within the next even three or four turns.
That said, you can afford to commit Phoenix to the board because it's just going to keep coming back. He's able to deal 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 damage. I mean, it's a massive
It's
attack.
A huge hit. It is a huge hit.
Yeah, I mean,
but this is the scary part.
You're forcing Floch to cast a mass removal spell that's going to get Ram off the battlefield. I mean, it's gonna, obviously you're more worried about it wiping your board. That means he's not going to cast a Revelation this turn. And I mean, Sperling again, yeah, can attack Floch down to 10. Oh, but Floch has Elixir of Immortality, so that represents five more life and a lot more Sphinx's Revelation.
Yeah, and he's got a Sphinx's Revelation in his hand. And this turn, though, he wanted to keep his mana up so that he could cast Last Breath plus another Last Breath or Last Breath plus Azorius Charm. And again, I have always, this is the thing that I always look for with these blue-white lists, is once they start Azorius Charming anything that's attacking, like regardless, you know, if it's a Mutavite, it doesn't matter, just Azorius Charm it, that's when you're pretty dead.
Right. Because what that gives the control player is perfect information, not having to worry about top decks, not having to worry about something crazy, preserving the life total. Doesn't need to cycle Azorius Charm to draw cards. You have other ways of doing that. Yeah, that definitely is a big signal.
Yes. It's also a signal that they have so many expendable resources that they can just start, you know, just burning cards on anything. And there we go. That's the death knell in my book.
Yep.
And a last breath to take out the other one as well.
And this makes it harder, too, for Sperling to force through things like Stoke the Flames, things like War Leader's Helix. I mean, you just can't play around Syncopate in any meaningful way when you only have four lands. And this is going to be a Jace. Yeah, it is.
Jace to draw some cards. And here we are. This is a matter now of going through the motions for Floch as Matt Sperling. I don't think there's any combination of cards that he can draw. We know his next draw step is a Mutavault. He's got a War Leader's Helix in his hand plus a Mountain. But even with like double War Leader's Helix, he's not going to be able to get there through what Floch can do.
I mean, I'm just trying to think about what can happen. I mean, you know, he's
you have
only
to be
got...
very creative, like a creative genius to come up with something. Yourself. And you are, you know, to be fair to you. If anybody could come up with it, you could. I certainly can't. There's no way.
But yeah, I guess you've got a blank off the Jace. You've got a blank off a Revelation. Sperling, you'd have to chain, like, Skullcrack into... It basically just needs to draw four damage spells for the rest of the game before Floch can muster a threat. I mean, Sperling's at 29 life. He's not going to die anytime soon. But, I mean, like you said, when Jace starts to tick up, that Floch's initiating that sequence.
Exactly. Engage. Yeah, I think the outs for Sperling start to become... drawing extra cards for Floch, punching a judge. Like, we have to go really deep down the rabbit hole to start to find ways that Sperling can win this one. I think that Floch just needs to decide his line for actually ending the game and execute on that.
I'm going to redirect to your Jace. So you stay at 20, I go to 32.
Okay.
Right, Sperling is looks like he's going to take out Jace with the War Leader's Helix.
I go to 20.
Yeah, you're at 20, I'm at 32.
And the sheep, the lone permanent that isn't a land on the battlefield, with its fleece made of dreams. Sperling's dreams rapidly being dashed right now.
They are.
Each point.
He looked at the top card of his library. He did keep it there.
Wow. Oh, my goodness.
Because he didn't have enough going on already.
Yeah. I believe that is the equivalent of still had all these.
Indeed. All right. So Chandra's Phoenix hits the battlefield here.
Yeah. that one results.
Last breathing it. It's four more life points for Sperling. Sperling up to 36. Not really a matchup decided by life total on Sperling's side.
Is it time for a big rev here? He's got two of them in his hand.
Yeah, I can't imagine not casting Revelation.
Yeah, so fire it off for six, 27. Put him up to 27. And we are officially in going through the motions territory as Ivan Floch looks like he is going to be into the semifinal here. Sperling, his first Pro Tour top eight. Going to have to settle for a quarterfinals, though. Still an excellent result for Matt Sperling. He said on social media he is no longer, he said he's not sick of it anymore, not having a top eight. Maybe a life changer for Sperling.
Oh, man.
Jace is back. Maybe a pair of Nick's Lease Rams. There they are.
Yeah.
Goodness.
Nope. Turn. Yeah. To land off the top for Sperling. Now, the question is, how much can Sperling take here, right? I mean, look, there's not a great reason to concede.
Yeah,
right?
Of course.
I mean, there's really no reason, but at the same time, you do have to sit here and watch your opponent go through all the motions, and it can be kind of painful at some point.
Well, I mean, your point earlier, you know, as far-fetched as it is, I mean, this is a deck that draws a lot of cards. It has a lot of operations. If your opponent just, like, Sphinxes Revelations for 13 and draws 14 cards, I mean, that's the game.
Mm.
So, I mean, it, you know, it's... Is it an out? Yeah. Is it a small out? Yeah. But, I mean, one is greater than zero.
Right. Right? And there's just straight up no downside.
Yeah.
Gain two.
So gain two life. And now we have a life race somehow. Ivan Floch is closing in on Sperling's life total.
Yeah. Jace at seven. Another quicken. Floch can threaten instant speed mass removal whenever he needs to.
Sperling still in the trenches here, draws yet another land. He's got Chandra Pyromancer in his hand and a pair of lands, so nothing going on. Mutavault not able to attack through two Nick's Fleece Rams.
And Floch just not worrying about attacking with his own Mutavault. Prevents him from revelationing for more. Floch not firing off revelations. He doesn't want to walk into a skull crack. No real compelling reason to need to do anything.
All right, Jace takes up to eight here.
Yeah.
Okay. And there's an Eidolon of the Great Revel.
Yeah!
Sperling with a little flourish there.
Yeah,
good guy. He's still having fun down there. I can't say I'd be.
Yeah, I'd be slumping in my chair with my head in my hands.
I'd be in full Bueller slouch mode at this point. No way.
Is that a patented variety of slouch?
Trademarked.
Uh-huh.
Six?
Yep.
Sperling 36. All right. Well, we've got a tie on our life total, and there goes the dice off of the Jace. Is this going to prompt the concession? No. Matt Sperling's going to play it out to the finish. I respect that.
Here is the deck. What can he get? He can get Chandra. Chandra, I guess. He can get... Young Pyromancer. Young Pyromancer are actually probably pretty sick in a blue-white control deck.
Yeah, you're totally right. Although very, very fragile.
Yeah, they're sitting there chaining quickens into each other. Might have to build a modern deck.
No kidding.
Pyromancer with Gitaxian probes. Then, of course, we're going to see Elspeth on Floch's side, I think. Oh, another Jace. Goodness.
You didn't board the Angels in?
No.
So now I think that, you know, Sperling and Floch both know the direction the game's going, and Floch just says, no, I didn't board in the Angel.
And Floch, didn't board in Elspeth either.
Four damn.
Yeah.
Five mana sorcery.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean,
okay.
Pyramids are actually going to be able to do a reasonably good Elspeth impression, I think.
I think you're right.
Yeah.
even if Sperling goes to kill the Young Pyromancer almost immediately.
You take two.
You take Sperling with the timeout. Solid knowledge of procedure there from Sperling.
A Dispel from Floch. Syncopate. Last breath. Answers to everything. More revelations. Probably a 40 life. Goodness. I mean, Chandra can enter the battlefield and kill that pyromancer.
I don't think Chandra's going to enter the battlefield, though.
Yeah.
I mean, here's Banishing Light.
Whatever would make you say that, Marshall?
There's about seven reasons.
I have five untapped.
Okay, so that's for six. I'm a token.
That's for six. I'll make a token. And then the Chandra can get countered by Dissolve. Alright, dissolve that, make another token. Moving on. And you were right, Zach. Look at that.
Yeah.
We're now at Elspeth levels of tokens. And it is before Ivan gets to untap as well, so.
Oh man, going off. Quicken.
Quicken make a token.
You having fun?
Poor Matt.
I actually do.
I think if you've played this deck for this long. If you weren't having fun, you would not be playing blue-white control with one win condition in your sideboard for 3 days of play at a pro
tour. I respect Yvonne's answer.
Really enjoy this.
Thanks for asking.
Yeah, Jeej. Sorry, man.
Four, you lose six.
So I got a
36, right?
36, yeah.
Sperling, 36.
So back down to 36 for Matt Sperling.
And Elixir.
I already plus this guy, right?
You did, yeah.
Okay, go ahead.
Basic mountain, a powerful draw for Sperling. Those Arabian Nights mountains?
No, those are just beta.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, the Arabian really Nights ones are a little more faded.
Seven.
I'm an expert.
So I go to four.
You like snapped that answer off.
I did. I've done a lot of research on this. I own one Arabian Nights mountain. It's in my commander deck.
And you talk to Patrick Sullivan a lot.
I wish. I wish I did.
Yeah, it's nice.
Talk to him
it
sometimes.
Is nice.
Every time I do, I'm happy I did. All right, so Floch fires off another massive Sphinx's Revelation, and I think you guys at home know the way this works. We've seen a bit of a clinic on Sphinx's Revelation just in this very match.
48 life from Floch. He's gonna, the quest is, can he a Johnny ultimate without a Johnny? Can he just get up to 100? It's a new race. It's a mini game. It's like Scheherazade. Talking about a lot of Arabian Nights cards today.
Yeah.
All right. So all of Floch's cards turn into whatever they do make a token. Cycle Azorius Charm, make a 1-1. Cycle quick and make a 1-1. Draw two cards, make a 1-1. Got a little engine going on.
All right, huge attacks here from Floch, who is finishing things off eventually. He's got a Nyx Fleece Ram. He's going to discard.
The nail in the coffin.
Yeah, that happened a while ago. We're talking about the flowers being brought a year later here. This is the widow visiting.
Okay.
All right. Let's make some more things.
Quicken. Accelerate the pace.
I assume you're brewing right now, Zach. Like,
I really am. I am so excited to play in Young Pyromancer Control.
And the charm. Okay.
You can use these upside down or something.
Oh, right. Can I?
I think he's actually ran our table judge out of tokens now. He's going for the North American record at some point.
Yep. Chain veil tokens.
Wow.
Just make it happen. Just keep them coming. Oh, more of an eye, yo.
Yeah.
Counterspell.
Untapping game 3.
Untapping game 3.
In response to the triggers, I'm going to skullcrack you.
All right. I love it.
Tight play from Sperling.
He gets dispelled, but Matt Sperling. You know, he's doing a great job of keeping it light. You know, he's not.
Block 53. Yeah, these guys aren't up. Then my draw step.
Goodness.
Attack with all these.
How many tokens is that?
He's hitting for 13, I believe.
Jeez.
Yeah, so that's gonna drop Sperling down to 13. Or 15, excuse me. He draws another skull crack.
Trigger on the stack.
In three.
56.
Let's it happen.
Sperling. 15,
Floch, 56. 56 is not a number I can recall seeing in the feature match table in a very, very, very long time. Get him.
Good luck with the top eight.
All right, and a handshake for Matt Sperling says, Yvonne Floch at 56 life and a million creatures on the battlefield. You are in to the semifinals. Whew. So it took a while to get there.
Yeah.
But that game was decided many turns ago. You know, we kind of already knew at some point there that that one was not going to last, or that it was going to last a while, but that it was effectively over. That's Zach Hill. I'm Marshall Sutcliffe. Welcome back to the booth, guys. But we do have our two semifinalists now.
Yeah, and we've got a sweet little young Pyromancer control brew that I'm going to go and make on Magic Online right when we get out of the booth.
Yeah, I like this idea quite a bit. Now, we're still going to be bringing you two more quarterfinal matches, right? So remember, if you guys haven't watched in a little while, we now line up the quarterfinals. We used to run them simultaneously and kind of jump around to what was going around, but instead, it's in a row. So you get to see every match we play for the whole entire top eight here on a Sunday. It's going to be a great day of magic, so grab a glass of water, grab a sandwich, or is it breakfast time? Maybe grab some breakfast and hang out with us all day. For now, though, let's head back over to the news desk where Richard Hagen awaits.
Thanks very much to Marshall and Zach. I'm here with Luis Scott Vargas. Luis, I don't really feel qualified to talk about that particular quarterfinal because I've rarely seen a card I like more than Elixir of Immortality, except possibly Sphinx's Revelation. So, you know, I'm kind of a little bit biased in that way, but that did look like a bit of a kicking.
Yeah, I mean, like I said, once Floch's deck gets rolling, there's really no stopping it. And the first rev is the most important one because it all just leads to more revs. That's the whole point of the deck.
Yeah, and well done to Matt Sperling, his first Pro Tour at top eight, and extremely gracious in defeat, because you've been on the wrong side of matches in the spotlight. We're all super competitive. It's never fun, but he conducted himself with great dignity and no little skill this weekend. So great job, Matt Sperling. But it is Yvonne Floch, the Slovak national champion, former Team World champion, who advances to the semifinals against Owen Turtenwald. That'll be our first semifinal a little bit later on. But we now turn our attention to the second part of the bracket, and our third quarterfinal is going to see Yuki Ichikawa of Japan up against Jackson Cunningham of Canada. So why don't we take a look at Yuki Ichikawa and see his profile for you. Yuki Ichikawa, he's from Japan, and he's only playing in his fourth Pro Tour here. And astonishingly, Luis, it's his second Pro Tour top eight. No one does that.
Yeah, I can't even imagine having played in four Pro Tours top eight and two of them. That's just absurd.
It absolutely is. And it's not even like you're playing the same format with exactly the same cards. He's just fantastic. If you don't know, he is arguably the world's most popular streamer of Magic the Gathering. Back in Japan, he is a proper rock star of the streaming community, has just crazy, crazy numbers. If you don't know much about him in real life, we know that the Japanese numbers are off the charts getting ready to watch this match coming right up. Why don't we see how Ichikawa made it here to the top eight of the Pro Tour Magic 2015. It began in draft, and how about that for a start? You face a now Hall of Famer, Paul Rietzel, then you go to 0-2 against Takeshi Ozawa, and then you have to face Matei Zatelkai to see whether you get out of draft alive at 0-3 or 1-2. He beats Matei. But even so, after five rounds, he's lost again to one of our semi-finalists, Yvonne Floch. He's sitting at 2-3 with three rounds to go. And then just look. Utter Leighton, Bull, Skaran, Lesh, Johnson, Bernice, Dos Santos Fiera, Seibold. And that back end, talk about backbone. Can you imagine trying to just go 3-0, back-to-back, Su Ching Kuo, William Jensen, John Finkel. Luis, that's an incredible run.
Yeah, I mean, he had to rattle off 11 wins in a row at the end there to make top eight, which is awesome.
Yeah, just phenomenal. Why don't we take a look at his deck? Because Yuki is playing Jund Planeswalkers. And Luis, there is a ton going on in this one.
Yeah, I really like this deck. I especially like that he maxed out on 4 Elvish Mystics and 4 Nissa Worldwakers and 4 Xenagos the Reveler. Those are all the really important cards, and he just figured it out. These are just the best cards. I should play as many as I can of all of them.
Can you give us a sense of what Nissa could or should do for him in this matchup?
It basically puts just like almost limitless number of 4/4 tramplers into play. And the fact that their lands mean they can't be detention sphered, they dodge ultimate price, they dodge a lot of the removal that gets played, and they're recurring threats. Even if you deal with the 4/4, Nissa's gonna make another. If you deal with the Nissa, you still have a 4/4 to worry about. So basically the whole way this deck works is incremental advantage, and Nissa's just a really big part of that.
All right, so that is Yuki Ichikawa. His opponent is Jackson Cunningham. Wow, again, experience, not really. This is his first Pro Tour, and he's in the top 8. Now, we'd like to bring someone from the testing team in to chat to us, maybe a friend. Well, this time, it's not just friend, it's family. Over at the easy chairs, it's Marshall Sutcliffe and Jeff Cunningham.
Hey, guys, welcome to the easy chairs. Marshall Sutcliffe, and I've got Jeff Cunningham with me. Now, Jeff, you're Jackson's older brother.
Right.
But you're also a very well-known Magic player as well. I remember I came back to the game 2008, 2009.
Right.
And I'm like, who is this Jeff Cunningham guy? Everybody knows you. You're known for writing.
Right.
All types of things like that. Now, has this been a little surreal for you, seeing your little brother make his first top 8 and his first PT debut?
Completely surreal for such a variety of reasons. He's very humble, but I had high hopes, and I was pushing him. But I didn't expect it, the whole Cinderella story, to come together the way it has, yeah.
How stressful is it for you watching him play? Is it more stressful for you to play yourself or to watch him?
Well, that's a nice consolation that when I used to play and I used to get into late rounds, it was stressful for me and I'd be playing. For this, it's stressful for me, but I can go pace and chill out and drink a glass of water. So I am enjoying being in the coach role.
Okay, now talk about the role that you have taken with Jackson over the course of your testing, and then also talk to us a little bit about your preparation after he made the top 8.
Right. I'd say I've been around the Pro Tour for a long time, and I've tried a lot of different methods of testing, and I know what works and I know what doesn't. And he works full-time, so he had a schedule and I had a schedule. So it was really the most efficient and successful testing I've ever had for any kind of Pro Tour. It was very analytical, discussion-based, and we just talked it through and worked it through. I came to him at the beginning and I said, these are the pillars of the format. Yeah, by the way, it's his maybe third constructed tournament of his life.
Wow.
And so I just explained it to him. We talked about the decks, played a few games, talked about how it felt. And just as it went along, we went from one deck to another, settled on this, very carefully tuned the sideboard, very precise, and we took it really seriously all the way through. Before we started, he said, my goal is just to make day 2. And I said, that's what everyone says for the first Pro Tour, and that's not good enough. You have to go higher, and we can go higher.
Wow, you have pushed him to the highest level currently. He's now in the top 8. Talk to us a little bit about what it was like last night after he made it. Was it emotional? Also, did you guys buckle down and get some testing in for this matchup?
He crashed quickly. We just went for food. He's exhausted. Most of the emotion came during the day and at the end of the day. Right, but then I went and tested the matchup and came to him with some notes this morning.
Do you feel like you've got it pretty well sussed out for him?
It's sussed out, yeah.
You know, because the deck that Ichikawa's playing isn't necessarily one that you consider a pillar of the format.
No, that's exactly it. It's a curveball, and we weren't expecting it, and we were more prepared, of course, for the pillars. But that said, I think we've learned what the deck does, and we've planned as well as we can.
Okay, yeah. And confidence level with the matchup? Do you feel,
hope for the best, but prepare for the worst. And
sure.
This is a tough matchup. Yeah.
Okay. How do you think Jackson felt coming into this morning? You said he crashed out last night. That's pretty typical after a long day at the tournament tables. When he woke up, was he happy, refreshed, or was he a little jittery? I know if it was me, I'd be shaken.
He's been a little jittery every day, but never so much that it affects him. He has a lot of composure once he gets into the arena.
I'm sure you have a big influence on that too, right? You can guide him, having been here.
It's nice having two people to manage those things, yeah.
Yeah, what was it like playtesting with your brother as opposed to some teammate that you happen to pick or something? I mean, do you guys, having grown up together, are you able to communicate very easily? You can cut out a lot of the overhead?
Yeah, there's just a lot of trust and good communication. So I like having a good friend. Yeah.
Okay. Jeff, thanks for joining us over here and having a chat, and we'll let you get over to root on your brother Jackson.
Thank
you.
But
for now, why don't we send it back to the news desk where Zach and Rich await.
Thanks very much, Marshall, and thanks very much to Jeff Cunningham. Zach, I'm an only child. I can't really imagine what it must be like, the stress and tension of watching a family member go through a top eight. Although the closest I think I've ever been to that was seeing Barbara Utter-Layton, Josh's mum, watching him in the top eight of the World Championships 2011. There's so much on the line, not just for the players, but for the support networks too.
Exactly. And I mean, I think that's got to be one of the upsides of testing with somebody who, you know, you're so close with, is that, you know, there's a lot of these magic teams, you know, they have your back, but if it's your family, you know, I mean, Jeff was talking about staying up, testing, trying to figure everything out, and just being there for you at the end of this. So I'm excited to see how Jackson does.
All right, so why don't we take a look in a little bit more detail at Jackson Cunningham. Now, it turns out his profile, well, that's a story largely to be written, is he is in his first Pro Tour, lifetime earnings of zero. His first three Pro Tour points came by playing here on day one, but he is already going to be at 20 lifetime pro points, even if he loses his quarterfinal, which of course by no means certain, and not played in many Grand Prix, 27-year-old from Canada. Why don't we take a look at how he made it to the top eight? Now, we've already seen a couple of players who were very much kind of behind the ball. Yuchit Chikawa, for example, was at 0-2 and put on a huge run. We've seen Owen Turtenweld have losses earlier in the tournament. But Jackson, he came out early, 3-0 against a decent draft pod. Then we went into standard, 2-1 over Gary Wong. Then he lost against William Jensen, but a strong finish, Mayam, Reeves, and Koska. Came back on day two, went into draft, and at that point you're thinking, okay, from 7-1, an unknown player in his first Pro Tour, loses to Owen Turtenweld, you kind of expect that. Pierre Mondon, okay, so he loses there. That's two in a row. Is this going to be a classic 7-1, 1-7 day? It was not. He went all the way, sweated the last round against Patrick Cox, but made it in anyway. And Zach, I can tell you that the players are ready. It is time for Jun Planeswalkers against Green White Aggro, Ichikawa against Cunningham. It's time for the third quarterfinal here at Pro Tour Magic 2015.